Thank you, Roberta. Good morning to all of you. We are switching fast to the next panel, talking about the future of computing, of quantum science, and of artificial intelligence. We have already listened many things about this field of research. Of course, there are important goals for humanity, for mankind, that can be achieved thanks to this kind of research. Let's think about climate change or molecular chemistry or material science, and we can name a lot more, I'm sure. But all of this is also changing the way science and research itself is being done. And this is the aim for which this panel has been built. And so it's an honor and a pleasure to invite here on stage for the introduction, Sandro Scandolo, ICTP Head of Research. Thank you for being here with us. Words. Sandro Scandolo is Senior Coordinator of ICTP Research Division, a member of the Condensed Matter and Statistical Physics section, an expert in computational modeling of materials at extreme condition of pressure and temperature, and one of the co-founders of the Quantum Espresso project. So we're very curious to hear from you. What's going on?
Thank you, thank you, thank you very much. So my job is to give you a perspective of what ICTP is doing in this field before we start with the panel. So I guess I don't need to convince you about the importance of scientific computing, especially after this panel. I mean, scientific computing has been, is actually revolutionizing the way we do science, many of us. I mean, from, you know, large scale structure of the universe to materials, design of new materials, forecast for the monsoons, proteins. I mean, we've seen the Nobel Prize in chemistry this year was given for the for a tool that essentially is able to predict the structure of protein. Of course, ICTP has been at the front line of research in applying scientific computing to physics as well as to other disciplines like chemistry and biology. We have strong activities in climate and earth modeling, for example, in our Earth System Physics section. We have, in condensed matter, we do a lot of simulations on materials for energy, in biochemistry. We also have a strong group dealing with quantum information and quantum computing, and you'll hear more about that later. We have also artificial intelligence, the fundamental aspects of AI and data science in our quantitative life science section, and also a little bit of experimental research in so-called edge computing, looking at using tiny machine learning devices to do monitoring and sensoring. Plus, we have in-house strong support in high-performance computing. We have a support team that helps us to do that. And also, we've been doing, in line with the mission of ICTP, we've been organizing several conferences, schools in all these fields. Not last, we organized together with CISA this master's program in high-performance computing. Of course, quantum, let me just, I mean, Atish, I think I was already mentioning in his presentation this morning, there's going to be a very nice and big conference next year in May 2025, jointly organized with Lincei on quantum physics, foundations and emerging technologies. This is actually done, is going to be one of the flagship events of the International Year of Quantum Science and Technology. International Year was proclaimed by the UN General Assembly and is going to be essentially run by, in collaboration with UNESCO. And you see, of course, the lineup of speakers. So you're all welcome to actually come back here May next year to for this conference. Of course, in the framework of ICTP, it's important to also ask the question of what is the role of ICTP in this very, you know, fast changing landscape. And of course, the question is how we can continue to foster science globally. Science here was done primarily at the blackboard until a few years ago. It's still done at the blackboard, as you can see, but there's also a lot of computational research that is being done. And I just picked one example out of probably hundreds of thousands, just because I know him personally, Daniel Shadrach from Tanzania. He's an expert in the molecular simulation of molecules that are interesting, that are important for the functioning of medicinal plants. And now he wants to extend his studies to use artificial intelligence to improve the modeling and perhaps come up with new drugs. This is just one example. And of course, the challenges that Daniel and, you know, thousands of scientists around the world are facing in the developing world is the lack of international collaborations, the lack of research ecosystems. If you want to do computational sciences, you need the computational infrastructure, you need experts that help you running the codes, and so on and so forth. There's also the question of knowledge expertise in these fields, which, of course, ICTP is here to fill. And also the lack of computational infrastructures is also, if you think at Africa, for example, the largest facilities in Morocco at the moment, but it's really, more or less the size, even less the size of our own internal facility here. So with this in mind, we actually convened a symposium in May, at the end of May this year, where we essentially gathered the scientists, experts, directors of supercomputing centers, all here at the ICTP to discuss what ICTP can do in this area. And one of the highlights of the symposium was the launch of this International Consortium for Scientific Computing, ICOMP, which Atis has already mentioned this morning. Essentially, this consortium is going to continue to support and to strengthen the support we provide to scientists from all over the world, try to facilitate access to computational resources, essentially making sure that scientists from all over the world are in a position to do computational research, at state-of-the-art computational research. And I don't want to take too much time. Let me just mention a couple of highlights of the activities of this initiative. In fact, it's very nice to have here Alessandro Curioni, who was also here in May, where we announced this joint prize for AI, artificial intelligence for science. And I'm glad that today we're announcing the opening of the call for this prize, which will be awarded, the first edition of the prize will be awarded next year in 2025. We also signed agreement with other European organizations to European supercomputing centers to provide computer time computational resources to scientists based in Africa. So we're acting as a sort of a hub, as the place where these kind of agreements can essentially take place, facilitate these links. So this is just a list of partners we managed to convince to join this consortium. It's a long list, and many of you are actually here. Many of these partners are actually, let me just mention that we just recently signed an agreement with Brazil. It was mentioned by Atish, and we're going to sign the actual agreement with CNPq in a moment. During the lunch break, but also, with South Africa. Francesco Petruccione is here. He's the director of the National Institute of Theoretical and Computational Sciences, and we're starting a collaboration with them, with scientists in South Africa. I'll just stop here, and I'm really looking forward to hear what the panelists have to say about this. So thank you very much.
Please take a seat and remain here with us. I call on stage also the other panelists, Alessandro Curioni, Urbasi Sinha, and Estelle Inack. Thank you for being here. Let's welcome them with a great word. Welcome and thank you for being here. So I'll present a little more in deep each speaker within the first question, so that we go a little bit faster. And I'd like to start with Urbasi Sinha, that heads the Quantum Information and Computing Laboratory at the Raman Research Institute in Bangalore, India, and is also Canada Excellence Research Chair at the University of Calgary in Canada. So you go up and down between India and Canada that are not so close. But the question I'd like to ask you is about India, and especially which is the importance of quantum science in development of a country like India.
So first of all, I would like to thank you for pronouncing my name right.
Okay, it wasn't so bad. Okay.
And pronouncing Bangalore wrong. So it's a qubit, so at least one is right. So first, let us just say, how happy I am at being here, celebrating the 60th anniversary of ICTP. Last time I was here was in 2018. And that was to, receive this award, ICTP ICO. And my daughter turned 7 during that. So, Atish, we don't need to wait for another birthday. I am a lowly experimentalist in the lab, but not so cheap, as was pointed out. But then, in a quantum, you cannot do experiments without doing theory. So keep it in mind if you want to see us come in a little more often than only on birthdays and celebrations. So with that, quantum in India. I think, quantum in India is something that is being talked about a lot. I mean, in the sense that it's really a very, very, you know, it's a buzzing field. And why is it? So just like ICTP had its vision for, you know, ICTP at 100, we have our vision for India at 2047, which is when we turn 100 in terms of our independence from, you know, what? So that is something we look forward to, and the idea is that we want to become a developed nation in 2047. And so one of the things which is a very important thing in becoming a developed nation is having, you know, technology development at a high level, at a global level, which is something we are concentrating on. So quantum obviously is a very important part of this program. Coming to, you know, some India-specific things which I believe are important for why we should have this development, make you aware a little bit of some national initiatives that we have. One of them is called Make in India, and one of them is called Digital India. So these are all, you know, initiatives which want, you know, through which we want to indigenize technologies and have them happen in India towards a digital economy. And obviously, you know, development in quantum contributes very well towards that. The other thing which you may or may not know is that a few years back, in order to suppress corruption to a certain extent, the Indian government decided that, you know, it would ban all large currency notes and actually encourage online practices a lot in terms of transactions. So even our roadside, vegetable vendor, they have their apps on the phone and we can transfer, you know, 10 cents, 20 cents to them just by using our phones. We don't need to do cash transactions. And so that is something remarkable we have achieved. But what that would mean is that we need to keep it secure. I mean, you know, we don't want these resources to actually fall in the wrong hands. And so quantum security and quantum cryptography is one way in which we can do that. And so that is something we are working on towards integrating it in our daily, you know, practices in terms of the digital economy. Another thing which I believe is India specific is, I think in the audience here, I think I can see a lot of Indian origin people, young and old. And that just means that, you know, STEM development, is something very strong. I think Indians are quite clever, not just in theory, also in experiments, just to make that point. But then they are all over the world. And so what this sort of a development in India will do is enable a little bit less brain drain and have that indigenous development contained within our country. So that would be another achievement of quantum developments in India. Now, the second point I wanted to raise here is our association with many global bodies. So I don't know whether you know, we are an important part of the G20. And so we also played a significant role in S20, which is the scientific part of the G20. And so through this, you know, we can help in cooperation in quantum within at least these 20 important initiatives, which are actually a large number. Likewise, we are a part of BRICS. Atish mentioned that in the beginning. And, again, within that forum, we can do a lot for quantum. Another one is the Quad, which is not as well known. So India, United States, Australia, and Japan. We form the Quad countries. And you can see that this is a combination of developing and developed countries. So we can adopt best practices from the developed nations, again, through quantum technology development. So these are, you know, some of the India-EU partnership is also very strong. So what have we done in quantum? So, I mean, you know, it's not just about, of course, dreaming is important. That was a beautiful talk. It left me dreamy-eyed, you know, what all we can do in 2047. But then, so while we are dreaming, we have not only been dreaming. So far as quantum is concerned, I think this is ICTP's testament to the fact that, you know, India has had phenomenal theoretical development in quantum, whether it's quantum gravity, quantum foundations, decades of, contributions, but not just theory. So in experiments, which is technology, right? Our Department of Science and Technology, Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology, Defense Research Development Organization, they have all funded projects in quantum for the last several years. And I myself have been a beneficiary. And, you know, that's why we are, you know, doing very well in free space quantum communications, which is one of my lab's main areas. Now, of late, last year, we launched the India's National Quantum Mission. And, this made India one of the 7 or 8 countries to have a national quantum strategy. And I think this is very important for us to understand that all the other countries which had it were not developing countries. So for India to have this vision already, to invest in something, whereas it could have done something else, is remarkable. And so we now are forming these technology hubs for the four important pillars. I am in the governing board. I wrote the roadmap document for this and have been trying my best to advise and strategize for the National Quantum Mission. And I do hope that going forward over the next 8 years, we develop stronger relationships with ICTP, for instance, in leading to growth, not just in India, but beyond. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you. Also for stressing the important connection between research and the development at every possible way, from social to industrial, economic, strategic, and so on. So let's go ahead with Estelle Inack, that is a research scientist at Perimeter Institute in Waterloo, Ontario, Canada, and also the co-founder of the quantum tech company IYANIQ. Hope to have pronounced it quite well. The question for you is, since your work is at the intersection between AI and quantum physics, can you give us some examples of real world problem that this kind of research and of development can solve?
Sure. You're probably wondering how come I have a startup as a physicist, right? So I did my PhD here at ICTP and CISA, and my PhD was focused on developing quantum Monte Carlo methods to simulate the behavior of quantum annealers, right? And I believe that the previous panel, we talked about simulated annealing from Kilpatrick, so I was doing the quantum version of simulated annealing with quantum Monte Carlo simulations. And at the end of our papers, we always wrote, okay, these methods can be used to solve real-world optimization problems. And I started feeling the more I wrote those papers, the more it just felt like a very nice thing to write at the conclusion of your paper to get it accepted as something that is promising. And so when I was doing my postdoc at Perimeter, we kind of combined this idea of simulated annealing with neural networks, and we created this method called variational classical and variational quantum annealing. And I saw the opportunity to actually solve real-world problems. And that's how we created my company. So, and then I had to learn about business that, you cannot just solve all the optimization problems in the world. You have to focus on one. And I decided to start with finance. So why not? It's all about money, right? So we are solving financial optimization problems, more specifically portfolio optimization problems. So you can just imagine it as a problem where you are interested in maximizing your gains, that is your returns, while minimizing your risk. So how could you think about it as a physicist? So since we are in a physics audience, I will give an example that we talked about in the previous panel, easing glasses, right? So we talk about easing glasses where you have spins that basically interact via some sort of disorder interactions, right? So how can I use an easing glass to model a portfolio optimization problem? So imagine that you have a basket of, let's say, stocks, and you want to select a subset of stocks to invest in. So selecting a stock, you can modelize it as a spin pointing up. And not selecting that stock is like a spin pointing down, all right? And basically, you solving your new quantum easing / portfolio optimization problem is finding the ground state of that easing glass problem, right? So this is just the one-to-one mapping between an easing glass problem and a portfolio optimization problem. So the disorder interaction are just correlation between the prices in the stocks, and maybe you have some sort of longitudinal disorder fields, and this could be your expected returns. And so for you to find the best way of investing in that subset of assets in your basket of portfolio is just finding the ground state of that easing glass Hamiltonian. And so we can use the techniques that we've developed over the years in statistical mechanics, mostly especially computational techniques like simulated annealing or simulated quantum annealing, and more recently even quantum annealers. So in my company, this is basically what we do. But we go beyond this kind of Kubo-like formulations because it does not reflect real world, which is one of the things that I founded, because you need to have some constraints and some real world constraints, one of which is when you have some when you're buying or selling a stock, right, you have to pay some transaction fees. And typically those are not very nicely quadratic functions. They are nonlinear functions. For example, if you want to borrow money to invest, it's called short selling with leverage. This also brings some sort of complication in the formulation of your objective function. Or if you have to pay taxes, we all pay taxes, by the way, on the gains you are making, you can also have some tax returns if you are losing money. And so you have to encode all of this in your new Hamiltonian. This makes things very messy for physicists because then, I mean, methods, traditional methods do not always work, but then you can use simulations. Right, and so what we are doing in my company, the way we are solving it, we talk about these other systems having, you know, these multiple solutions, possibility of having multiple solutions, but how do you go from one solution to the other? Right, if you have to do simulated annealing, I mean, you have this equilibrium time that scales exponentially with the system size, so you cannot really sample with thermal fluctuations. Maybe you could use quantum fluctuation if you can encode a problem in a quantum annealer, but what we do is that we use AI, and we use basically deep neural networks, because as we know, large language models, for example, are able to sample complex correlation between words in a language. But what we do is that we use those deep autoregressive neural networks to sample investments, as you will sample a spin configuration. Now, the problem is that you need to be able to train it, okay? We know that these language models are extremely powerful. They can represent very complex functions, but how do you train them? Because in financial optimization, you don't have data. But you have an Hamiltonian, you have an objective function. So you can train it by variationally minimizing that Hamiltonian, either by encoding fake thermal fluctuations or fake quantum fluctuations. So this is basically the technology that we use in our startups, combining these ideas of statistical physics and deep neural networks to solve financial optimization problems.
Thank you for these very clear examples, and good luck with your startup that has been created 3 years ago, if I'm right, okay? And then I'll come back to you asking something about your experience here in ICTP. Let's complete the first round of the table with Alessandro Curioni, that is Vice President of IBM Europe and Africa and Director of the IBM Research Lab in Zurich, in Switzerland. You have been mentioned a few times this morning since IBM is doing very much things for ICTP, and in particular, ICTP recently established an international consortium to allow the open access to facilities and the knowledge needed for advanced computing technologies. But the question I have for you is, which role can a big company, a global company like yours, have in international cooperation to ensure equal access to these technologies and to this knowledge?
Thank you. Let me spend the 2 words before answering your question. You said that, you know, IBM is doing a lot of things in collaboration with ICTP. I want to say that I'm very, very honored to be here at the 60th anniversary, because ICTP and the theoretical physics community has done a lot of things for IBM and for our world. You know, we are speaking today about AI and quantum computers, and definitely these are going to be very powerful instruments that also the scientific community is going to use. But you know, you will not have a quantum computer without having quantum information theory and solid state physics. You will not have these two things without having quantum mechanics, and you will not have quantum mechanics without foundational research and fundamental sciences, right? So having institution like this one that promotes basic science and theory and physics is vital for us, you know, to push the next step and to create these technologies that, if we do in the right way, are going to bring benefit to science and to the society. So you said what we are doing ourselves, right, to try to make sure that this technology is develop as fast as possible, and it will be used in the most inclusive way as possible. We start from one consideration. We, since the beginning, when the technology started to be mature enough, right, to do the next step, you know, quantum computing, we are speaking since several decades, a lot of big contribution, as I told you, but started to be realized and become real 2015, 2014, 15, 16, right? Since the beginning, when we had the first devices that you could use, so they were stable enough, they were usable enough to try to do something useful, as soon as we had that, we have put it on the cloud to try to push the scientific community to try to use it since the beginning. You know, this was never happened in the IT industries. In the past, in most of the other technologies, you know, before you bring the technology out, you need to be sure that it works, that nobody can compete with you, that you have something that, you know, create huge value, is mature enough. With quantum computing, has been a different thing. Why? Two reasons. One, because everybody understood how transformational the technology was and the need to accelerate its development as fast as possible. Okay? Second is due to the fact that quantum computing uses a different representation of the information to do computing, was super important that not only the hardware and the system was developed, but also the algorithms, the theory, the application, the integration of quantum with classical as fast as possible. Okay? So since then, you know, we had only 5 qubits in the cloud available for the scientific community. So now we have 30 systems with 1,000 qubits, much larger scales. There are 600,000 users of quantum computers, our quantum computers in the world. We have calculated more than 3 trillion of circuits, and there are more than 3,000 high-level scientific publications in the field using quantum computers. And most of the cases, you know, the focus when people speak, it's accessibility of the hardware or the research of the hardware, right, in different places. That is thought to be, you know, the differentiated piece of technology. I have to tell you, and that is what we are doing a lot, that is not what is going to make a difference. Because this, at a certain time, is going to be mature and will be done by different people, different companies, different places. What is going to make a difference is the ability of scientists, researchers, people to use it efficiently. So education, skill creation, and scientific broader community that try to look at old problems with a new lens is what is going to make a difference. And that is why, you know, we ourselves, we are collaborating with institutions like ICTP in the world, exactly to make sure that this skill development, education, and scientific, let's say, development is done in the proper way. You know, if you take a quantum computer and you pretend to use the quantum computer to solve problems in the old ways, yes, you will have some advantage, but it's not going to change the world. Rethinking science problems in this lens, as, for example, some of our panelists are doing, is what we need to do. And that is in the best way, in our opinion, to have an inclusive growth and accessibility. Education, creation of skills.
Thank you, Alessandro Curioni. The paradigm is really changing because of this evolving knowledge. You were talking about knowledge, community, institutions, of course, companies, and the big picture. I'd like to go back to Estelle Inack for a more, let's say, personal question in the sense of your own path of career. We mentioned before that you were here in ICTP, so the question in this anniversary is which role has had this experience in your life in terms of knowledge, in terms of expertise, of experience, and in what you are doing this right now. 3 minutes for each one for the second round, because we don't want the lunch to get cold.
Sounds good. I would say ICTP has had a critical role in my career, you know. Earlier this week, I was in Zurich. I was visiting a collaborator at ETH. Many of him, of you know him, Professor Juan Quartz-Killer, recently got a professorship there. He also did his diploma here at ICTP, and he also did his joint PhD between ICTP and CISA in Condensmatter. This is the same kind of path that I had. I did my diploma here in condensed matter physics, and I did also my PhD between ICTP and CISA. And both of us were talking, and we both agreed that ICTP, without ICTP, I mean, we wouldn't have been where we are right now. Absolutely not. Why? I will tell you three reasons. The first one is basically opportunity. You know, I am originally from Cameroon, and for a typical Cameroonian bachelor or master student, it's nearly impossible to have admission for master or PhD abroad for many reasons. And even if you have admission, I mean, you cannot pay the fees, you know, international students' fees. I mean, it's nearly impossible for you to pay. So it means that already you don't have that opportunity. And that's the story for many, many people from the Global South. So this has been crucial for me to be able to come to ICTP under a fully paid scholarship. The second thing is basically teaching. Unfortunately, still in the Global South, it was true in Cameroon, it's probably still true now, even though somebody may have a bachelor or a master, the substance compared to somebody who has done a bachelor or a master in Europe or in the US is not the same thing, right? So there are still gaps in the knowledge. And so the diploma program was really crucial for me to fill those gaps and to have access to knowledge that I didn't have back home. Right, so this was really very crucial for me to, in fact, have an admission at CISA. The third one is research excellence. You know, my diploma thesis was already on using quantum Monte Carlo method to simulate quantum annealing devices, which I did my diploma 10 years ago, by the way. Now people are thinking about it as maybe something normal, but my supervisor at the time was really visionary. I told him when I wanted to do a project that, oh, I'm interested in working on Bose-Einstein condensation. I was like, yeah, Estelle, this is a very fun topic, but there's even a hotter topic, quantum computing, you know. And yeah, and basically some of those algorithms that I developed in my diploma, we are using it currently in my startup to solve real-world optimization problem. So this speaks volumes on the impact that ICTP has had on me as a researcher and on me as an entrepreneur. So thank you very much, ICTP. I cannot thank you enough, in fact.
Thank you for sharing your experience here in ICTP. We are talking about how the paradigm, the model of ICTP is changing and improving the way scientific research is being done. In all of this, of course, new technologies, new ways of making science. I'm thinking about AI, of course, but also quantum computing are changing the way everyday researchers work in their job. So I'm going back to Alessandro Curioni to ask to tell us something more about what's going on in the way AI and quantum computing are already changing the way of making scientific research and what is going to change in the next years.
Look, I was already saying before, these are two super powerful new instruments that the scientist has in their hand, right? The new AI, you know, is not only language. Yeah, you can take almost any structured data that we do have, that we measure to understand our world, and use very similar methodology to create foundational models that encode, you know, a new way to understand a given problem, right? And this is going to help both to understand better how our world is working and eventually challenge some old way, but developed over hundreds of years, right? We have represented our reality. Yeah, so it's going to complement a challenge also theory. Quantum computer on the other side, we already have a different representation. It's going to take all new problems, but not new problems, normal problems, are exactly the problems that scientists tried. I am a computational scientist, has tried to do or to simulate since many, many, many years. Simulating nature, simulating physics, has a very bad complexity, computational complexity on classical computers. You can do it with quantum. The other things she mentioned, optimization, yeah? It's having the ability to do global optimization much better, huge impact in science, also the business. But the third one, and I want to go back, and it's a synergy that I do hope that all the scientists here in the room are going to get and eventually get the challenge, the synergy between quantum and AI, quantum and machine learning. What the classical machine learning is able to do, okay, we do know, but there are certain things, for example, finding hidden structure in data, small set of data, but complex data. Normal classical machine learning is not able to do it. Quantum computing will be able to do it. So the interface between quantum and machine learning, in my opinion, is all to be explored and is going to bring back a lot of value and is a promise that, you know, the scientific community should focus on.
Thank you very much, Alessandro. Undoubtedly, each of these technology is very important to science, but putting them all together will give some kind of superpower to scientists. One last question for Urbasi Sinha about the importance of making available quantum knowledge and quantum application. In which ways do you think ICTP, of course, with all its partners, can make this possible?
So thank you for that question. I hope the first course is salad because then it won't get so cold. Yes, so I'll take 3 minutes and just 3 minutes to answer this. So if I want to take 3 minutes, just 1 minute or 1 second, I would say ICTP should just continue doing what it does because that's its mandate. I mean, you know, it has been beautifully brought out in everything we have heard so far. So that is what it does. So it does it for science. Now you can just say do it for quantum science, which is a bit more focused, right? So I'll just read out this, which I got from the website. You know, it's a unique institution that explores fundamental scientific questions at the highest level, promotes active engagement with scientists in developing countries, and advances international cooperation through science. So obviously, you know, so just doing all this for quantum is the idea. But then now, some ideas on how it can be maybe a bit more quantum focused. So one thing that is specific about quantum, which I think does come out in whatever the panelists have been discussing, is that slowly it is becoming a very critical technology, and it is leading to some geographical tension, right? We do hear about these declarations from important countries about banning, you know, export of quantum technology. So it's not something countries are willing to share. Okay, and so now we are talking about equitable development of quantum. So it's an important question, and it's a tricky one, right? How do you do this for something which countries are now treating, with a little bit of caution, right? So one thing that we can go back to the first panel where, you know, it was said, a lot of very important points were made about fundamental science. So there is a difference between science and technology. And so scientists like us, you know, even the lowly experimentalists, we do like to talk and collaborate and cooperate with each other. And that is how we thrive. Yeah. So if somebody has already done something, I don't see the point of reinventing the wheel just because it is quantum. So we do need to learn from each other and accelerate progress in science. So the distinction between science and technology, especially in the minds of the policymakers, is important. Because I think, you know, people here mostly in the audience are from from the scientific background, we know this, what to say and what not to say beyond a point. But policymakers do tend to blur this line a little bit, and so that means you cannot share anything, and that's a problem. So if we can make this distinction clear and, you know, through our engagements, I think that is something maybe, you know, ICTP can do well. So Sandro mentioned about one of the focus events next year being this huge event, which I wasn't invited to, on quantum, right? The Int'l, you know, I can't lose this opportunity to, but then on a more, so then make it more accessible to the developing countries. You know, we are going to become developed in 2047. So till then, we do fit into that background. But on a more serious note, I think this is the beauty of ICTP, right? That it is actually a neutral ground. You know, while it's very beautiful, your slide had that beautiful picture, it's a neutral ground. So we can actually have people from countries come in and discuss, which otherwise may be not very possible sitting in our individual locations. And because, you know, we have this freedom of doing this. It's almost like, you know, the Geneva of science. I mean, you know, so this neutrality that is very important. And I think that is what we should focus on. So already you are in the Open Quantum Institute, right? So I'm also there. Maybe we see each other on Zoom much more than otherwise. So Open Quantum Institute is this initiative which is about enabling and fostering equitable, you know, access to science, right? Quantum science. And so IBM, I have a question for you. You know, you do charge us a lot of money for those things that you said, you know, we are doing. I mean, you know, so maybe somehow you can make a bit of an exception. No, you're very rich, yeah? So make a bit of an exception, collaborate with ICTP, And reduce, you know, maybe for this, for the JESDA initiative, right, which is about sustainable development goals. So now, for such initiatives, if we could have a little bit of an access which is even affordable through such partnerships, I think that would be very encouraging, because ICTP can do that. While JESDA is doing it, but then ICTP can do that for the geographical thing that I was talking about. So I think that is the kind of, you know, small examples we can take where ICTP's uniqueness comes through. And secondly, you know, ICTP is excellent in organizing conferences that have been to and not. Yeah, so these workshops and, you know, things that are organized. So quantum-focused ones, obviously, even more than what you have already been doing, I think, because it's an excellent forum for such organizations. Then the inclusive development part, already OQI is there. Now we have International Year of Quantum. So while, you know, I'm in the World Quantum Day, I represent Asia there. So we are all trying to popularize quantum. But maybe more than popularizing, if we could also focus on how to make it inclusive, have brainstorming sessions on that. Because it's a hard problem. How to make something inclusively available where countries are putting sanctions on it is not the easiest question that we are ending this panel with. But I think with this unique mandate of actually accessible science and you know, international cooperation, I think ICTP is one of those unique organizations which can do this through such examples of already your engagements, but beyond. By, you know, focusing on, you know, new definitions of inclusivity. So that would be, I think, it was 3 minutes.
Yes, it was, okay. Definitely. Thank
the
you
way,
very much.
We don't charge a huge amount of money.
There is
still a free access, and many institutions that got access to this, like, for example, CERN, they give it for all their more than 100 counter institutions for free.
So I myself got some access as a, I mean, no, you have programs to give access where I don't have to actually pay. But of course, on a more serious note, agencies like IBM and others can actually make a difference in this equitable, you know, access. Yeah.
And you're obviously invited to the conference next year.
Room full of witnesses. I mean, you know.
The decision has been made. Thank you to you all for sharing. The title of this panel was The Future of Computing and Quantum Science. We've talked about the scientific point of view, the human point of view, and the future we want to create collectively from your different countries, from your different perspective, and from your different ways of creating a better world also in this sense altogether. So thank you once again to our panelists. So Urbasi Sinha, Estelle Inack, Alessandro Curioni, and Sandro Scandolo for having been here.